It was incredible how few people offered up introductions on their own, but how welcoming they were to our being asked a question. I really do remember seeing it tick up, both going, oh my God, we're doing it, and then having that sinking feeling of, oh, we've got to do it now. We think the right hiring strategy is to reflect what you are most useless at and hire them first. What we then made the decision to do about mid last year was basically just swap that roadmap around. The climate disaster is already happening.
This is the Leeds Business Podcast, and I'm your host, Phil Fraser. This week's episode is slightly different as we meet a startup, Peter and Will, founders of green banking startup Tread. Peter and Will share with us how they came up with the idea in the first place, what it feels like when you've just raised £1 million in funding, the effect the Bank of Dave had on them, plus they teach us five simple ways you can reduce your company's carbon footprint. There's also a chance to win one of 10 Tread water bottles, but you'll have to listen to the end of the podcast to find out how to do that. Before we start, I have one simple request. Please hit the follow or subscribe button on the app that you're listening to. That's it. Thank you. So, let's get into what is a really thought-provoking episode. Today's episode of Leeds Business Podcast is slightly different because we're talking to a startup rather than an experienced business person. Today I've got with me Peter Kirby and Will Smith of Tread. Good afternoon, guys.
Hi, great to be here.
So, very, very briefly, because we'll come back to it at the end, tell us what Tread is.
Yeah, so how you manage your money has a massive impact on the planet, whether it is through where your money's kept or what you're doing with it. And in the UK, there isn't a business current account that helps you do both of those things. And so Tread is a green business current account that doesn't invest in fossil fuels and instead donates to tree planting projects. But also it does all of the carbon accounting and carbon footprint calculations automatically on top of that.
Okay, great stuff. And we'll talk in a lot more detail further down the line. So firstly, guys, sort of give me a brief background on your business journeys to the point where you came up with the idea. So Peter, we'll start with you.
Well, we actually met in university in 2011. We both studied mechanical engineering, met in the first lecture of all things and became friends very quickly. But after a couple of years, realized that as well as enjoying labs together and doing coursework together, we might want to start a business together as well in the future. I think sensibly said, we're not going to do it straight away. Instead, we're going to go out into the world and get a bit of experience and learn what it is to manage a calendar and deal with emails and all that adult stuff. So we both became consultants. We specialized in operational consultants, which meant being deployed into businesses from hospitals to aircraft carriers to supermarkets and everything in between, always looking for opportunity or to increase output or data visualization. So we specialized in working out the decisions people were struggling to make and giving them information that helps them make those decisions. That's where the idea, like one of the backbones of Tread came from. We realized that businesses and individuals are pretty uninformed about their carbon footprint. So we said, well, what can we do to support them in on that journey of reducing it?
Okay. Will? You're going to say same as him.
Pretty much. I guess the kind of where we differed slightly is I kind of focus more on the people side of things. So it was more once you have that data and information, it's how do you actually inform a person and make them want to do something about it. Worked across a load of different sort of bigger corporations. And then I then thought, you know, because we were starting Tread, it was sensible to actually work in a startup before we kind of jump ship. So the constraints that exist in big companies don't necessarily exist in small companies and vice versa. So worked for a startup for 6 months just before Tread, learned things like what's it like having a small team, not infinite amount of money, and the constraints that puts on that. So really interesting, like to kind of get both of those two, and then we kind of jumped ship.
So just to go back to what was the startup, and again, just give us some more clarity on what you think you learned while you were there.
Yeah, so it was a company called Mouse who make phone cases. So they're indestructible. You might have seen them on YouTube or the internet. They throw their phone cases out of windows, go in front of the Apple store and throw them up in the sky, brand new phones. So their whole USP was around an indestructible phone case. What I was doing there is I spent 6 months working with the COO, doing a lot of mini projects on their like operations. So how they're getting how they actually design the products, how they order the right amount of products, how they get it from, because they make them in China, how they get them across the UK efficiently and effectively. then did a lot of work on like what should the phone case cost. So a lot of like negotiations with factories and things like that.
Right. Okay. And while you're doing that, Peter, you're still...
Still at Newton. My last project was during COVID. So I took a sabbatical for 3 months. I left working on a dockyard in the Lake District, and I came back to working fully remotely from my flat at the time, working for number nine of all things, the Cabinet Office.
Okay.
And we were working on a project called Shielding, which was about ensuring that people that couldn't leave their home, even to go to a supermarket, got the right supplies to sustain themselves. It was an incredible project to work on. Benefited Tread a bit as well. It was my first experience in completely remote teams and how to keep people both motivated, but also in tune with one another. Because it's a huge challenge when you go from an office where you can just tap someone on the shoulder and say, did you know about this? No, off we go. To trying to keep a team in sync remotely. But that's what where I was, did some really cool stuff, hopefully helped a lot of people. When that finished, it was time to say, right, bye Newton, off I go, let's give Tread a try.
So there'll be lots of people listening and watching who've maybe had a business idea or think, oh, I can do that better. So just talk us through the you know, where did that seed of the idea come from? What triggered it? And then at what point did you go, actually, we might have something here?
Well, there's kind of two sides of it. Well, so the actual process we went through was, you know, we'd been using data sort of in our day-to-day role pretty much all the time. And it was, at that point, we said, right, I did 3.5 years. And I said, right, now is the time that I think we're ready to actually give a business a go. And so, I mean, we've been keeping a list of, what, 70, 80 ideas, something like that. All just like little things that we kind of encounter in our day-to-day lives that are a bit of a problem. But we then kind of went, I went a bit more methodical, which was, okay, we really wanted to make a difference and kind of have a positive impact. And so I literally process mapped my life out, which sounds really sad. But I basically went through that and said, right, well, you know, the kind of problems that exist in day-to-day lives. And then there's overarching ones like climate change, home ownership, etc. And I really thought that climate change is this big problem that's only going to get worse if no one solves it. So what should we do about that? And then it was, well, I don't know what I should be doing to reduce like my carbon footprint. And then a lot of research later then found that actually money is probably one of the biggest impact things, because A, of the hidden emissions of funding fossil fuels through your bank and holding deposits in a bank, but also the impact that your spending has as well. And so that kind of was the seed of the idea. And then, yeah, kind of went on from there.
Okay. And Pete?
I love that Will's just told that story. That's the truth. That's how it actually works. It's methodical. It's time. It takes time. And there's loads of crap ideas before that. Then you hear this thing called the founder story, which is what most people tell. Will has his own founder story. Go on, give
it. I was going to say,
it's really cool insight. Like, so you come up with your founder story about a year after you actually come up with the idea, because you want to be able to sell the product. Yes.
Right.
The actual slightly more tangible story is that I was sat in a restaurant in Glasgow. I was working on a dockyard at the time. I was in a restaurant with a friend, and you know, I asked for a drink, and it came with a little plastic straw in it. Sparked a whole debate about what was worse for the planet. You know, they had the straw, but I then pointed out that they'd flown from London to Glasgow that morning. And so we had this debate, what is worse? They had a real go at me for having the straw in my drink, and it just came with it. But it was that kind of like seed of, well, actually, what is worse? Is it that plastic straw, or is it the, you know, the flight, or is it the food we're eating, or is it the hotel that we were staying in at the time? And that really was, again, the kind of foundation of, okay, actually, no one really knows what to do about climate change. So we need to give them the information and kind of display it, and then helpful tips, etc.
Right. Okay.
Good story. Probably kind of happened.
Yeah. I mean, it did happen, but
but I think the point I want to make is, it wasn't for us anyway. It wasn't this moment of inspiration, this spark, yeah, this light bulb moment. It was a lot of hard work and effort, especially from Will. He had a slide deck. It was every time he came up with an idea, put another one on and start analysing it, put another one on and start analysing it, until we got to the point where we thought market conditions, pressure because of the environmental disaster we're facing, our capability and the expertise and the network we had, we were all falling into place. So that idea at that time was worth going for it.
I was going to say, so you've done your hard work, or you've been looking at plastic straws, whichever story we might want to believe. What's the first step? I assume you sat around in pubs and flats and sort of brainstormed it. What's the first step that you did?
Yeah, so the kind of going from the, I think this is actually a good idea, through to, okay, I'm actually going to leave my job for this. And it was kind of the same thing for both of us. So the first thing that we did was, you know, I had a chat with Pete and said, look, I actually think this has got legs as a concept. We kind of talked through, brainstormed, okay, what is a green current account, and what could we do with it? How could we help? That came up with a wish list of ideas. It basically split into two camps for us. And what we then started doing is, could we test the hypothesis or the idea that people actually want this product? And how do we do that as cheaply and as quickly as possible? And so for us, there were two halves of it, which was, one, people wanted a digital current account on their mobile. We didn't think we needed to test that because Monzo, Starling, et cetera, had already kind of proved there was the market for that. So the bit that we then focused on first was, you know, do people want to know their carbon footprint? And so, I mean, we literally built a really scrappy Excel. We used expense data from some colleagues and sort of gone, okay, based on, you know, transactions or bank statements, can we do this? Was step number one. And then we showed it to people and said, do you think this is useful? Would you use something like this? What else would you want it to do? And started really learning about that. The feedback from that was actually quite positive. So then kind of each step, we then improved it slightly to go, okay, well, actually, let's not use exported bank statements. Let's link through open banking to people's actual current accounts. Then it went kind of, and that allowed us to raise money and kind of went forward from there. So it's like, what's the cheapest, easiest way and simplest way for you to just test your idea, whether it's through surveys, it's interviews, it's speaking to your friends. And just that's kind of how we started.
It's interesting you said that, because I don't know if you've listened to Dan Priestley's episode on Diary of a CEO with Stephen Bartlett, and he's talked about creating waiting lists. So just creating a waiting list as the same sort of thing you did, just testing whether somebody's interested. And then, you know, if people aren't interested, you go on something else. So just wheel back a bit, because you've covered quite a few things there. So you've got this idea, and then you said, oh, we plugged into people's banks. How did you sort of get around that? How did you do that?
So the first version was just asking people for Excel reports from their banks. And that was when we were dealing with friends and family, people that were comfortable sharing information with that. The second version of it was using technology called open banking. Open banking has been mandated by the European and the UK financial regulators for years now, but it's the capability for yourself or a third party to connect into your bank account and extract information like balance and transactions. There's a few use cases for open banking. Frankly, it's been mandated, and there's a lot of skepticism of whether it's been adopted very well, because there aren't many good use cases for it. One is, it's a very quick way of assessing your debt or assessing your balance, because you can pull together your credit card, your debit card, your savings account, your interest account all into one place and do the maths. We were one of the first to realize that same technology can be used for carbon footprinting. So Will's told the good story of MVP. I'll tell the bad story, which is, we made a big jump. We said, open banking is a really good technology. Let's get an app. Let's get it into the app store, so as many people can use open banking and Tread to connect their other bank accounts, pull in all their transaction data and calculate their carbon footprint. Did we need an app? Did we need to go to that extent? Probably not. It took months of development. We bankrolled it at the time. We were still, this is pre any funding. So we paid for it, for a development team, that a third party development team, to build an app for us, just so we can really test the water with open banking. Took too long. We did learn a lot, but it was a very expensive way to go about it.
Okay. Were you said you bankrolled it yourselves. Were you still employed at the time, or had you jumped ship by that point?
Yeah. So the actual timeline of it. So we were quite pragmatic. So when we came up with the idea, it was in December. We registered in December 19, I think it was, or December 20. It doesn't really matter.
December 2019.
We then were quite pragmatic, and it didn't need us full time. It was just testing a couple of ideas, a few hours a week, just pulling together like some packs, some introductions, that kind of thing. So We then worked for the next 9 months on other businesses. So I did the startup at that point. So we started Tread. I then worked for 6 months. And then what then happened is I then started doing 2 days a week Tread once it started getting a bit more full time. And then we had built the app, I think, at that point. And then we kind of went, right, we have an app. We think it's worth it. We need some funding. And it was at that point we said, right, if we're going to get funding, we have to go full time. And that's kind of where the proper journey of us going full time went.
Okay. I'm not gonna ask you how it felt to jack in your jobs for a startup, because I think everybody can guess what that feels like. I've done it myself. Talk us through the first stage of finding funding, because again, something you know a lot of our listeners and viewers maybe haven't experienced.
I think in a word for us it was networking, and originally not really for funding. We realized we're not ex-P firm or anything like that. We don't have a huge network of entrepreneurs or people that support entrepreneurs, and we needed to get it like really quickly for a load of reasons, including funding. So we went back to our networks. Some really key ones early days were we went back to the business school that was within our university, but relationship with them. We went to all of our colleagues and said, who do you know that does a startup? Can we speak to them really quickly? We were really like where Will worked, Mouse, they were also very supportive. Their old HR manager gave us an hour a week. Can you remember?
Yeah.
To say, hey, boys, starting a business. Have you heard of employee liability or an employment contract or risk and government? All the things that you're not really taught at school or uni or in your first job. And become fundamental when you're a founder. So we were networking, we were growing and growing. It was in the time of COVID again, it was very easy to have a 25 minute conversation with someone and spend the last 5 minutes saying, you know a bit about us, you hopefully don't hate us. Who else do you know that you can introduce us to? It was incredible how few people offered up introductions on their own, but how welcoming they were to our being asked the question. All we needed to do was ask and they'd say, oh, I know this person, and obviously I should introduce you to them, and bang, 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 bang. And we met heads of ESG at retail banks in Europe and the UK. We met some incredible people just through that mechanism of introduce us. Then we realized we needed funding. The reason we realized we needed funding is the MVP I spoke about using open banking just wasn't enough, because the customers at the time said, I do not want another app. I want a Tread app, I want a Tread payment card, I want Tread banking facilities and the technology that you're building for us. Please provide that to us. And two people can't bankroll the development for that, nor can they build a relationship with the schemes and the processes to do so. So there's a turning point, we need to start raising money. We went back to that network we built and they started telling us how to do it and who to speak to.
There's a really interesting point you said there, that you know people weren't proactively offering their network, but once you asked, they were all very happy to do so. And I think that's really, really key, that most people are quite happy to say, oh, I must introduce you to so-and-so, or I must introduce you to so-and-so, and just from asking. And a lot of people just don't ask.
It's the one big thing we always say, fellow founders, just ask. Like, it's not just introductions. If you ask someone, can you teach us how you do your customer support, even though if they're a vague competitor, most people are very happy to do so. Most people, especially in the industry we work in, which is ESG, are very comfortable supporting other businesses in the sector in elevating their status and gaining customers.
Brilliant. So that first funding round, if you want to call it, was that just sort of ad hoc friends, family and network, or was that a formal funding round?
Yeah, so we did a formal funding round at that point. So we kind of rallied together. The first person was the hardest to corral. I mean, there's some techniques that we used that weren't very successful. Like Pete said, the networking one's the best one. We tried cold outreach on LinkedIn. So we had some automated bots going, and that was that just wasn't very good. we did a whole host of stuff like that. It was a formal funding round. So we ended up raising just under £1 million, and it was split into two halves. So one was like friends, family, angels, but the predominant was actual external angel investors. What we then had done is we then decided that our product was an individual's product. It was consumer facing. And so we decided actually we should try and do some crowdfunding at the same time. So we ended up doing a crowdfunding campaign So alongside that angel round, so we kind of went in with a chunk of angel money. And then the remainder came from just individuals supporting us, which, you know, we were super flattered that and very honored that I think it's over 1,000 people decided to give away, you know, invest 10, 20, 50 quid, even £1,000 into our startup, and they believed in us. And so, yeah, that kind of formed the basis of it all.
Okay. And how does that feel when, in effect, somebody's then suddenly put £1 million in your bank account and you go, shit, we've got to make this happen now? Is that how it felt? Or
yeah, I'm gonna think you go through seconds of joyful pride, like we've done it, and then immediately it's the pressure of now we've got to really do it. It's daunting, it really is, especially because it's individuals. We're not talking about high net worth individuals. We're not talking about VCs who are really savvy on risk. We're talking about people sat in a pub saying, I just put £5 into this business called Tread because I saw a video of them online. The pressure is huge, but rewarding. I think you've got to appreciate those first 1,000 people were also our first customers. They're people that are still engaged in Tread, giving us feedback. They're walking billboards. They're brilliant marketing. They're a valuable group. But yeah, I really do remember seeing it tick up, both going, oh my God, we're doing it. And then having that sinking feeling of, oh, we've got to do it now.
Fantastic. And in terms of just while we're talking, in terms of supporting Tread, we actually will have a competition to win a Tread branded water bottle. Will, do you want to show us the Tread water bottle?
It's a bit, there you go, look at that.
Those who are watching on YouTube, we've got a very nice white and green Tread water bottle, and there will be a competition to win one at the end. Well, it won't actually be at the end of the show. It'll be actually in the marketing of the show, but you get what I'm saying. You get what I'm saying. Okay, so the money's in the bank. What do you do next?
That's a good question. So I think the first thing we did is we sat down and said, okay, where do we want to get to? And we did this kind of before the funding round, which is kind of where are we right now? Where are we trying to get to in terms of this funding? And therefore, what have we got to prove to reach that like next milestone, which would be kind of the next funding round and kind of generating revenue, et cetera. So we were really clear on what that looks like. And that was just from me and Pete sitting down and going, okay, cool, does this sound sensible? And then asking our network and going, okay, what things have we missed? The next focus then was around building the team out, because, you know, we were using an external provider to build all of our apps. And so we said, look, you know, kind of number one priority is making sure that we have everything in-house. And that is the experience, the expertise. We actually have all of the technology and we know how it all works and fits together. And so that was kind of our number one priority. And then found out which, you know, I was about to say which skill sets are kind of mine and Pete's. And then from that is what did we need to complement each other? And so kind of built the team out, got an office and, yeah, kind of went from there. It's a whole, yeah.
That's the right hire. We think the right hiring strategy is to reflect what you are most useless at and hire them first. So our first hire was in marketing, and really helped us shape the brand, shape the strategy, and then shape the marketing approach. I think the other thing I'd point out, Will's experience in a former startup taught us both that cash is absolutely important. And it's easy to see £1 million in the bank and think, great, EV fleet for the team that we don't have yet. Really shiny office. How high can we get in the skyscraper? That kind of thing. But we've always put controls in place. We've always had a business plan with if we do really well, if we do what we hope to, or if it really doesn't grow as quickly, how much money do we need in the bank and where should we be spending it? And we've been quite good throughout the last 3 years at allocating spend properly.
Okay. Okay. And at this point, did you have a working app that people would use, or was this still, are we still in build phase at this point?
This is build phase. This is that funding round gave us the cash we needed to set up the card program, because there are upfront fees to get connected to MasterCard and faster payments and backs and chaps and that kind of thing, to hire the team who were going to build our IP. So a lot of our banking infrastructure and our climate technology is completely ours. We don't leverage third-party technology, so we needed to build that ourselves. So we got the money in. I think we spent about 4 or 5 months in pure build, and then started an alpha beta testing phase where we started onboarding customers.
Now, that's a great point to stop at, and we'll come back to the story. I need to tell everybody about the Leeds Business Podcast Fair Deal. The Leeds Business Podcast Fair Deal has two sides to it. My side of the deal is every week I bring you inspirational, motivational and fascinating business owners like Peter and Will, and that's totally for free. Your side of the deal as a listener or a viewer has two parts to it. Part number one, recommend this podcast to one other person you feel will get benefit from it. And part number two is to post it a review on whichever app you're listening or watching this on. That's it. Fair deal. Sound like a fair deal, guys?
Yeah. Depends what the review is for us, but hey. Yeah, very fair deal.
You have to give Peter and Will a good review. So you've got to A-B testing, okay? Tell us how that went, because I'm sure people have been through this and know that A-B testing doesn't go anything like you think it's going to go. What did the feedback come back at?
So we launched our initial product, and we always wanted to start with consumers. So I guess our kind of roadmap was going to go consumers and then going to launch a business account as well. And that was kind of always the strategy. A kind of a high level, what we learned from our consumer offering was that actually there were more and more business owners using our product. So we kind of launched our product, onboarded what, 8,000 or so people.
Wow.
From that, we learned what people were doing, you know, where people were spending. And there was so much analytics in terms of where people's carbon footprints were actually versus where they thought they were. And that in itself was like real validation of the product. So kind of the first thing that we learned, that actually there was legs in a green current account and the carbon footprinting thing. What I think we didn't expect to find that we did, which is interesting. So talking to customers, I spent hours on the phone with them, was that quite a lot of small business owners were actually getting the, like, linking in the Tread to the Tread account and using that as a kind of like financial hub. And we found that actually there were quite a few of these business owners, and that was kind of the, when asking why and diving into it, it was that, you know, businesses are being pushed and kind of wanting to have a greener stance as a business, whether they're being pushed by individuals, their customers, by, you know, they're in the supply chain of larger companies, which are kind of forced by legislation, it's government grants, et cetera, et cetera. So there's a big push for them. And they were saying, look, there isn't a green current account for my business, and there isn't one. So what I actually want is the Tread account, but for my business. And I think that was the kind of learning for us, was individuals eventually, businesses had more of a drive, but individuals, there was the cost of living crisis, which I don't think kind of helped our case a bit. But actually it was, there was very much a want for it, but there were other kind of priorities for individuals. What we then found is that the business owners were, hence why now we're doing the business accounts, because actually the kind of bigger market, more demand from them as well.
Okay. And was business accounts on the roadmap, or was that just something you added on?
Yeah, no. So it was always a strategy to do consumers, test it. They're a bit more forgiving, if I'm really honest, because I have three or four sort of like credit cards, debit cards in my pocket. So we were always going to test with them. The idea was to launch that, then launch a business account.
Right. Okay.
What we then made the decision to do about mid last year was basically just swap that roadmap round. So prioritize the business account and business customers, and then swap back at, well, launch again the consumer accounts sort of further down the line.
Right, okay.
Which is a difficult decision, to be fair.
Couple of questions just out the back of that. You said you got 8,000 testers. Where did they all come from?
You mentioned it earlier. One decision we made, and I can't remember why, was to build a wait list.
Okay.
Yeah. So we too have had so we had a website with a sign-up form that allowed you to capture information and get early access. My reflection of the waitlist is, so it's a double-edged sword. It was fantastic because we had a community and a list of emails that we could start marketing to, helping them understand the product, helping them make the decision to get a Tread account. That was great because we could do some of the work early. And as soon as we wanted testers, we could say, hello, waitlist, who would like to raise their hand and be one of the first testers? There'll be bugs aplenty, come squash them with us. That was brilliant. My experience with the waitlist is it's very easy to see it as almost a vanity metric that could be increased with low quality signups. So there is always a barrier in an onboarding flow from you are not aware of who we are as Tread to you are an active customer. Where you put up the real barriers, which are normally proper commitment of here's my personal data, or here's some money to financially commit to your product. You can put that really early on before a sign up, which means your wait list doesn't grow very well. But you know you've got high quality people waiting for your product, or you can put it very late on into the app, meaning your waitlist balloons, meaning you've got a really exciting, you've got a growing community, but arguably you've got some people on that waitlist who are just there to listen in. They're probably trying to sell you something. They're not going to get a tread product, meaning that the conversion of our waitlist wasn't as great as we hoped it would be.
Just to clarify something for people here, you very clearly on your website say you are not a bank, but you're a banking platform. Just clarify that one for us.
The UK's regulator is fantastic at giving opportunities to new businesses to provide payment products, I think is how I'd frame it. It's called they're the FCA, the Financial
Conduct Authority.
Conduct Authority, thank you. So years ago, they introduced a scheme of electric money. So banks are banks, but other businesses can like piggyback off their banking infrastructure to provide e-money accounts. And that is why we saw things like Atom, Monzo, Revolut, Starling, new challenger banks or neobanks, as other people call them. That was the first wave and was designed to shake up the banking industry, because really there are just five or six retail banks in the UK. That's where everyone is. More recently, EMIs were allowed to rebrand or offer their services to other smaller businesses as well. So anyone who sits under the EMI umbrella, which is ourselves, cannot call themselves a bank, because the FCA wants to make sure there is a distinguish between banking and banks and the likes of ourselves. It's interesting to look at it, because from a customer's point of view, what are the differences? You can still put money on an account. You can still have a debit card on your phone or in person, walk into a shop and buy things. There's two major differences. One is we can't lend any money. So the money you hold with us needs to be ring fenced. We can't go and offer savings accounts, loans accounts or mortgages. The other one is the FCSS protection scheme. So if a bank goes bust, a maximum of £85,000 of your funds will get returned from you. The government promises that. Ours is a little different. There isn't that protection, but as I've just said, your money is ring fenced instead. So the money is sat there in a pot ready to go back if a business like us goes bust.
So would is a customer depositing the money with you in very simple terms?
Not with that. So that money is held with a safeguarding company, safeguarding account. So there are now banks again, but they're not really banks. They're safeguarding banks that hold the money for you, and they will choose where to place it. But it's normally with the Bank of England ring fence, so it can't be lent anywhere else.
Right. So if I got a, I apologise, I haven't got a Tread card yet, but I will immediately after this show. If I had a Tread card, I can deposit money into my account, which is then held by the Bank of England, and then just spend it like a normal debit card. I assume I can't have an overdraft, because obviously you're not lending any money.
Yeah, exactly It's basically you to a customer, it looks and feels exactly the same. It's a debit card. You put some money into an account. It's held. You can make faster payments. You can have direct debits, Apple, Google Pay, all that kind of stuff. But what you can't do, or what we can't do, is then take that money that sits in a bank account and then loan it to someone else, which is how kind of the big banks make the money, and how again the money that you hold at the bank then starts funding fossil fuels. It has a carbon impact, and so that's kind of where we found out.
Right. Okay. I'm going to have to ask this question, because I'm sure people who are listening and watching are going to say, Bank of Dave, is that sort of parallel to what you're doing?
We love Bank. How far is it that way? It's like 20 miles that way. No, two days. It's like absolutely, you know, hats off to him, you know, amazing job to have done it. And I absolutely love the film. For those who haven't seen it, go and watch it.
They film in a pub in Leeds as well.
Do they?
Yeah, it's a really good pub in Leeds. What he did, he was before the FCA even introduced those EMIs. So the way he shook up the banking industry for the UK, you could argue if he didn't do that, Tread wouldn't be here for the day today. So I would love to have a success story like the Bank of Dave. Who knows, if a Netflix documentary is made about us for the good reason, not the right reason, we've done all right. But you know, hats off to what he did, paved the way in this industry and has helped us out.
So where are we now? We've got live business accounts, we've got live current accounts. Anybody who wants to set up a Tread account just goes to tread.earth, is that right?
So as Will said, last summer we made the decision to move to business banking.
Okay.
So we spent the last 3 or 4 months setting up the infrastructure, building the relationships, ready to go. We are weeks away. So in April, we'll be launching to our first subset of customers. That list is already full. We've got our testers. They're all ready to go. From June onwards, we'll start onboarding sets at a time. So like last time, we're building a waiting list. Like this time, we've learned a bit from it. So you've got to commit a bit more. You've got to tell us a bit more about yourself. But we're curating a group of people, businesses ready to go. So our plea right now would be, if you're interested to learn more about Tread or get a Tread account within the next couple of months, go to our website and sign up there.
And it's tread.earth.
Yeah, tread.earth. I think tread.com's a car company.
Right. So it's Tread, TRED.earth, EARTH.
Yeah, like planet Earth.
Seriously, people who are interested, having listened to this, who would like a business account with you, they can sign up, get on the waiting list, and you'll be in touch.
Yep, absolutely.
Okay, back to the question I forgot I was going to ask. How do you know how green people's spend is or isn't, and how do you do the whole green thing?
Two sides of the coin. One is the fact that moving your money out of a retail bank to Tread reduces your carbon impact because the money that you're holding with a bank isn't being invested in new fossil fuel projects. So that is externally verified. There's a company called My Mother Tree who have done some incredible work to work out £1,000 held with Barclays, Santander, Lloyds, etc. has these carbon emissions. So we use that information to say, hey, you've moved to Tread, you've saved this from your carbon footprint. I think a really interesting side note at the moment, this is quite specific, but the government's guideline on how you calculate a carbon footprint for a business doesn't include the impact your money has or the bank partner you've chosen. We calculated Tread's carbon footprint last year. If we were banking with the worst of the offenders in the retail banking space, our carbon footprint would be about double what we report on. So huge impact just by understanding that and moving it. The second is then the impact of your business activity, your spending, your employees, your suppliers, everything like that. Leeds is really fortunate. It has one of the best, if not the best, climate schools in the whole country. They produce the data that DEFRA and the government use for calculating carbon footprints. So our journey started with them. Will's already said that we came up with an algorithm that said, given a transaction, what is your carbon footprint? There's a few layers to that algorithm. First, it takes information curated by Leeds University and Lancaster University as well. That information says, if you spend £10 on petrol, your carbon emissions are probably X. We do a few things to refine that for the business. One, we built an algorithm that says, given what the transaction says it is, it's probably scope 1, 2, or 3. That's really important for a business's reporting, as you're supposed to split it into the three scopes. The second is we've added some overlays. So one is price indexing. The cost of fuel is changing every day. That needs to be reflected in your carbon footprint. The second is vendor specific. So a litre of petrol from an Asda fuel station compared to a Shell garage is slightly different. That needs to be reflected in the carbon footprint. And the final is your business choices. So we capture information about the business on when they're paying their utility bill, is it gas, electric, or just electric? And other things, and we use that to like change the sensitivity of our calculations. But the summary of it is we take transaction data automatically, do a load of clever algorithms that the team have done, Will and I definitely haven't, to output an estimated carbon footprint split by category, vendor, and scope, meaning you can report on your carbon footprint to whoever's asking, and you can start making meaningful changes by focusing on the biggest things.
Okay, and that leads brilliantly into this week's how-to. Take it away, guys. And I'm sure our listeners can guess what this how-to might be. So off you go.
We're going to talk about how to reduce the carbon footprint of a business. Shocker. But it's important to us. It's the technology that we've built, and we're seeing more and more businesses ask, what should I do? The number one thing for me, the first step, is to actually appreciate why it's important for not just the green businesses around there, but every single business. When you start reading into it, it's a bit doom and gloom, but the climate disaster is already happening. We're seeing hottest months and coldest months, wettest months and floods, and that's in the UK, and that we haven't been impacted as much as other places in the world. To get it right, it's not going to be just politicians, it's not going to be just businesses, it's not going to be just technology, it's not going to be just individuals, it's everyone. So we all have our part to play. So first step, acknowledge and appreciate that you are part of the answer. And do some research if you don't believe that yet. Step two, just like if you're trying to lose weight and you step on the scales, you need to step on the virtual scales to understand your carbon footprint and your impact. So there are many different ways of understanding a business's carbon footprint. You can allocate the resources within your team to go and do the research and collect the data themselves and calculate it. That's people time, but it's very doable. It's what Tread do for ourselves. The second option is you can go external. There are amazing consultancy firms out there who will come in and do that for you. But that can be very expensive. Or the third is to use an automated service like Treads. So regardless of how you do it, get a read, understand your carbon footprint. Once you understand your carbon footprint, I'll come back to what I said. So third step is to realize that there's a hidden danger in that. The hidden danger is your carbon footprint is far greater than you just calculated. And that's because where you are choosing to put your money, which is your bank, has a large impact on your carbon footprint. So please go online, understand the impact they're having. There are recommended switches. One of them is to Tread. But if you're a bigger business or too complex for a Tread product, there are better and worse retail banks for you. So go move that money. Right. So you put money in the right place. You understand your carbon footprint. It's time to start reducing. For me, there's two things here next. One is there will always be a tactical thing to do that you can do very quickly that is effective. So look for those quick wins just so you can start reducing your carbon footprint, because other things are expensive and timely. What's a really quick change that we made is we stopped buying new technology. So when a new starter joined Tread, we used to buy brand new Apple laptops. Well, if they were lucky, brand new laptops. We realized that secondhand laptops have about 10% of the carbon footprint. They're also cheaper and high quality. That was a quick switch, but it reduced our carbon footprint massively. So look for the quick win, do that. Then find, well, I think two more stages. You need to start looking at the bigger buckets. So if the majority of your carbon footprint is your diesel or petrol fleet, or if the majority of your carbon footprint is the energy you're using on your factory, they're really tough things to change and expensive, but you do need to lean into them now. You do need to have a strategy. You do need to start influencing it. So even if it's a 5-year plan, if you can reduce those carbon footprints, that is the important thing to focus on, not the tail end that isn't really going to move the dial. Start doing them. And then the final thing is repeat it. If you do an action, re-record it, see the impact you're having to keep the dial moving downwards. It's a continual loop, and it's important to go back round again and again and again. There. Would you add anything?
There you go. So good. They can't even add anything else. It's absolutely fantastic, because that's real stuff that people can do who think, oh, I must go green, but I don't know where to start. So that's really, really, really great stuff. Final question then, and I ask all guests on here, who's your shout out to? Who are you going to give a shout out to in Leeds?
My one would be Becky Baker at the moment. She's a fellow entrepreneur in Leeds, and she's got an awesome journey so far. For those who don't follow it, Becky's first startup was a company called K9. We are both dog owners, so this is really close to our heart. She was supporting us in understanding where we can go with our dogs. So what pubs will allow dogs and what won't, where is a good walk for a dog? Like, you go to a new community, where is dog friendly? Unfortunately that business didn't work. So very recently she had to call it quits and focus on a new thing. I would say the UK's attitude towards startups failing is pretty chronic and creates an environment very difficult to work in. The fact is something like 99% of all startups fail within the first year. It is more likely than not that a startup would fail. Yet there's still a stigmatism, and there's still a really poor approach to what happens when an entrepreneur fails and has to tie up their business. I would argue that that ends up, that's a self-fulfilling prophecy. entrepreneurs are probably not taking enough risks in the right places. They're not being bold enough, confident enough because of that black cloud over your head of failure is not taken well. Becky has lent into her failure. She's currently doing a series on LinkedIn about all the things she wished she knew first time that she's applying to the second time. And it is so valuable. I've read very few people read a LinkedIn post top to bottom, I'd say. I've read Becky's start to finish every time. I think the way she's leaning into the first failure for her second new startup, which is fantastic. It's called Receipt Safe. It filters out all the receipts from your email so you can just go to your receipts and do your expenses very quickly. Great idea, real problem people have. So for her attitude through her first startup to her second startup and her second startup success, I'd call that Becky Baker.
Okay.
Yeah, to be fair, the one thing that I think we've both learned is that the things that we've learned the most from as a team, individuals, is the stuff that hasn't gone quite right. Because you can kind of dissect it. You go, oh, okay, why didn't that work? What would we do differently? Whereas if something goes well, you're like, well, I'm not really sure why that went well. was it pure luck or was it, you know, a stroke of genius? And I'm probably sure it was the luck, not the genius. So I think that's kind of where we've progressed our products the most is through learning, dissecting. And I think that's also kind of an attitude thing as well, which Becky has, which is, you know, there are no failures. There's only learning opportunities.
Yeah, and I would totally agree with that. I'm connected with Becky. I read them as well, and what she's doing is fantastic. I know Becky quite well. Will, you just mentioned there that the biggest learnings come from the failures. What has been the biggest failure and learning as a sort of final question from your journey so far?
That's a really difficult one. I actually think. I wouldn't say it's the biggest failure, but I think it's one of the biggest learnings that we've taken through, which is, I was going to say it was the kind of the way that we managed the waiting list. I actually think so probably one of the big ones, which was making it as low barrier to entry as possible. So we kind of had this vanity metric that we were chasing. I think it's really important that, you know, taking it as sort of a level up, which is focusing on the right metrics to drive and the right things that you should be focusing on is really difficult. But you should always be focusing on what's the actual value to your business. And I think that's probably the biggest learning that we've taken through. So is it having 50,000 people where you've just got their email, but they're not really interested in your product? Or is it having 1,000 people that have paid you some money for it? And I think that I can't remember who said the quote, but there's a kind of learning that I've kind of gone through recently, which is it's better to have 10 people absolutely love your product than have 1,000 people hate it. And I think that's kind of the main focus for us going forward is how do we really get like the valuable customers? And then once you've got that, you can then learn and then kind of go forward from there. So I think it's focusing on the right metrics.
Great stuff. Guys, it's been a fascinating journey so far. We all wish you all the best. And everybody now, go and sign up and get yourself on the waiting list. Thanks so much, guys.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening. I hope you found that interesting and thought-provoking. To win one of 10 Tread water bottles, simply go to www.leedsbusinesspodcast.com/tread. That's T-R-E-D. And answer the question there. The answer was in the podcast. And don't forget, please hit the follow or subscribe button on the app that you're listening on. Thank you. See you next week.